Well, my name is Mark Stevens. I'm a Denver-based writer. I write mysteries, but I also am a publisher. And the only reason I'm a publisher is because my good friend Gary Reilly passed away, unfortunately, in 2011, before he had a chance to really find a publisher for any of the 25 novels he left behind. When he passed away, he left a three-sentence will, and one of the sentences in that will gave me and my friend Mike Keefe permission to do what we wanted to do with his books. And in 2012, we started publishing those books. And on June 23rd, we will publish the 11th novel. And this particular novel is called The Discharge. And it happens to be the third and final entry in a trilogy about a Vietnam private named Private Palmer.
Book Lovers Unite! I'm Demethius Jackson, and you're listening to the Chapter One Podcast. The greatest stories ever written all begin with Chapter One. In each episode, our guest authors will share their first chapters with you. This episode is different from any I've ever done in the past. So today I'm going to be speaking with Mark Stevens, who's an author based out of Colorado. But what's interesting is he's actually promoting the books of an author named Gary Reilly. Gary was a prolific writer who passed away back in 2011, and he left behind a mountain of books that were unpublished. And so he gave permission to his friends, Mark Stevens and Mike Heath, to take these books and publish them, which Mark Stevens and Mike Heath have been publishing ever since. So we're going to be discussing that today, along with the most recently published book, which is called The Discharge, part of Gary's Vietnam series. This is going to be a really interesting conversation, which starts right now.
One night before the permanent cold of winter set in, it rained. Palmer turned off the lights in the basement apartment and sat near the window smoking cigarettes and looking out at a streetlight, reflecting off a layer of water on an olive-colored Dodge, which belonged to a man who lived in the apartment on the top floor of the house. His brother Mike had gone out with a friend and would not be back until the bars closed. Palmer was thinking of renting an apartment of his own. His father, who had served in the Solomon Islands in World War II, used to say the one thing he had missed most during the war was to be able to go into a room by himself and shut the door, and Palmer had always understood this on a basic level, but now he understood it wholly. The rain came harder, and he thought of a night in Vietnam when the rain flooded the compound, the storm so heavy he had felt safe for once. He put the thought of it out of his mind because it was a pleasant memory, and he refused to attach any nostalgia to that experience. Instead, he thought of a girl he had known before he went off to war. She was 18 back then, who met with him after he returned, his first attempt at a date after that year. He felt awkward hugging her, and the few times he kissed her, the gesture seemed dishonest, like the kisses one gives to a prostitute in a puerile attempt to get more than your money's worth. He was upset that he was unable to make a truly emotional contact with her, but did not let it show. And when he said goodbye to her, he knew he would never see her again, and regretted it only on an intellectual level. It was not simple after a year of intense precaution to let someone near him, and he smiled it off with the wisdom of an advice columnist who might suggest that, given time, he would readjust. He resented the fact that although he was aware of many changes he had undergone in the war, he had not been aware of this one. After remaining aloof for weeks, the first night he went drinking with a friend named Matthews, he found himself trying to be the same person he had been when he went away, as if concerned about the possible effects the changes within him might have on the people who had known him before. The rain slackened, and he closed the window shade and turned the lights on. He had gone out drinking a few times after he got back and met with men he had known in high school who had all changed as he had, some, in the war. He felt nothing in common with them, and when Vietnam was mentioned, the only facts revealed were what kind of unit served with and where, and nothing was said. None of the things he was sure they, too, might have liked to say about the war. He stopped going to bars. On the occasion that he did end up in a bar, it was across Denver, in neighborhoods unfamiliar to him where he never ran into anyone he knew. He drank alone in his apartment or with others in their apartments, but with others the point was not to visit, but to get drunk. He began experimenting with wines. He had no wish to become a connoisseur. He simply wished to find something palatable and steady, like a weekly TV show which attempts to do nothing more than serve its intended function. Pinot Noir, Madeira, and an amusing night on Tokay, worse than motor oil. He found his own level in sweet red wines and looked no further. When he did not want scotch or beer, it was pink Chablis, at least two bottles to get him through a night. He drank it by the glassful with cubed ice as he was drinking it now. The rain was like fire crackling on the tin hood of the Dodge, and he pulled the window shut because his bare feet were getting cold. He had called the house where Celeste's parents lived, hoping she might answer the phone. She had entered the University of Colorado at Boulder the same month he was drafted, and he was hoping she might be home for the weekend, or better yet, had dropped out. No one answered the phone. He took pleasure in fantasizing the misfortunes of the people he had once known, and he thought perhaps Celeste had gone away to school, had become liberated at last, and found herself changing diapers with an unfinished degree on her conscience. He would drop by some evening when her husband was not at home, bringing a bottle of chilled wine which she would turn down, just as he planned, sophisticated in the corduroy sport coat he always imagined himself in, scouring the countryside like an avenging angel, seeking out old acquaintances and saying, "Look at me, I went away to war and not only didn't die, but came back perfect." He opened the second bottle of wine, pouring it over the rounded pink cubes in his glass and began dressing. The first bottle of Chablis had warmed him, and he felt toward the world as one does shortly after an orgasm, relaxed and kindly. He dressed slowly and lit a cigarette, capping the bottle and putting two packs of matches into his coat pocket. He stepped into the rain and looked beyond the glow of the yellow bulb above his head and listened as each drop struck distinctly the tin awning. Small rivers had formed in the drowned grass. He did not hurry to his car, worried about his hair as he might have years ago, setting out for Celeste's house. He carried the glass with him and the wine filled with rain. The interior of the Buick was dry. It muffled the sounds outside, and he leaned on the massive steering wheel and finished the glass and set it on the floor of the back seat. He owned a 1953 Plymouth in those days. The engine blew up in Nebraska on a visit to his parents before his induction. He wrote Celeste one letter from Basic and was not at all surprised when she didn't reply. Matthews wrote and said she was extraordinarily popular at Boulder, and he had no illusions about what that meant. The rain parted for the Buick, the reflected streetlights gliding across the bulbous fenders, and he followed a road he could have driven blind. On this night 2 years ago, he was in his third month of basic training. Men were on the moon. Each day was now measured against a moment in the past. Down this darkened street 2 years and 4 months ago, he had driven. She against the passenger door, far and hard against it, he silent, fragile with the feeling, the knowledge that it was all over. They had finished their last fight. Nothing he did seemed to please her, but that was true of almost everybody he had ever known. A single blinding streetlight shone at the corner. In the middle of the block, beneath heavy trees, her house was dark. He came down the street in the direction he had come that night, watched the parked cars rolling slowly past, and looked at her approaching house. The windows were black. That night, one single yellow window had been lit up, the hallway, her parents waiting asleep. She got out of the car before he even put it in park. Now the rain stopped, because the entire street was protected by a tunnel of leaves, and he looked at her house, and the white light at the end of the block shone through the wet tracks left by the rain on his windshield. He did not know if she, her parents, still lived there. The house silent, each house on the block was dead to life. He pulled at his Chablis. He brought a small sampler whiskey bottle filled with beer to this house one night, opened it in secret with her, and she was disgusted and turned her head away. He eased the automatic shift into D so that the Buick would take him away, because he did not think he could ever take himself away from anything on his own power. At the end of the block, he stopped and looked both ways. He had no reason to touch the steering wheel or the gas pedal. He drank the wine and looked at the rectangle of black, his rearview mirror. He dropped the shift into reverse. The transmission housing at his feet screamed briefly and went silent. Gorge rising, he delicately lifted the shift into drive and felt the transmission catch, the car gently rolling forward. All the way back to his apartment, his breath was shallow. He did not touch the wine. He drove darkened side streets and watched for cops. He touched the brakes and gas as little as possible and prayed that his Dynaflow would come through this one last time. Rolling to the curb and braking, he took a quick swallow of wine, then ease the shift into R. He would be buying the car from his brother, no reverse.
Well, first, there's just so much that we can talk about here. I mean, again, it's really touching what you and Mike Keefe are doing. And I think the story of you supporting your friend's work is just as compelling as the books themselves.
Well, I appreciate that. And it is moving. We have heard many, many words of appreciation from his longtime girlfriend who supported him during all the years he was writing. His brothers and sisters are also deeply appreciative, as is anybody who knew Gary and how much he devoted his life to writing fiction. It wasn't like a big choice for me or Mike Keefe. It was just a matter of fact. We would not be able to rest knowing that those books would be sitting somewhere unread. And we've been proven by the reception since they've been published. Three of the books in his taxi cab series called The Asphalt Warrior, three of them have been finalists for the Colorado Book Award, which is the most prestigious book award in Colorado. They've been favorably reviewed by Booklist, which is a tremendous book review site. Also had some nice mentions on National Public Radio, and National Public Radio has twice talked about how much they like Gary's works. And there have been some other nice reviews and commentary along the way. So our goal was to find Gary's audience, which he never really had a chance to do. And we think we're finding that audience.
Right on. Could you tell us a little bit about Gary and his work?
Sure. Well, about Gary, Gary was, first of all, just one of the nicest, kindest people you'll ever meet. He was also a bit of a loner. You know, he had many friends, but he wasn't the biggest social guy out there. And that kind of comes through in some of the characters he writes about. He was from a large family that moved around quite a bit. He basically grew up and did a lot of his schooling here in the Denver area, and then did serve a year in the Vietnam War, which became the inspiration for the Private Palmer series. And later drove a cab for, I think it was 13 or 14 years here in Denver, which again inspired his 10 novels about a taxi cab driver. Very offbeat, fun, quirky books. He was just a story fan. And by that I mean he loved stories in any form. He loved movies. He loved good TV shows. He liked offbeat, weird TV shows. He liked offbeat, weird movies. He could browse. I would go with him to the used paperback bookstores, and he could go in the back shelves and poke around, and he would have read most of what was back there. He knew all the kind of 40s and 50s noir authors, the old school classic dime novel stuff. He loved the beats. He loved the beat writers. And he would talk to you about stories. He would talk to you about plots. He read my books when I was unpublished, before I started getting published. He was a big, huge help to me in terms of thinking about my story, what I had, what ways it could be improved. And he would also, whenever I would mention other friends who were in the same position of writing their novels, he would ask if he could have a chance to read their manuscripts, just so he would have a chance to see what they were doing, and often weigh in with ideas as well. He was very generous with his time. He was just a great guy.
So you and Mike were authors before this publishing venture?
I had been writing fiction since the mid-1980s until I met Gary in 2004, but then I didn't get published till 2007. My pal Mike Keefe, he and I met at the Denver Post when I was a reporter there, and Mike spent 37 years at the Denver Post as the editorial cartoonist. He actually won the Pulitzer Prize a couple years before he retired. Mike knew I was a big fan of fiction, and he said, if you're a fan of fiction, you've got to meet my friend Gary Reilly. So Mike introduced me to Gary in 2004, and Gary and I immediately hit it off. Mike is also a writer in his own right. I don't think he's had any fiction published, but I know he's an excellent short story writer and an excellent nonfiction writer. I've seen lots of his work, and he's a tremendous writer who he reads a lot. he's an omnivore when it comes to reading fiction, and he's a big reader of nonfiction as well. And we have talked about books and writing for many, many, many years.
Is it difficult for you to balance this project with any of your other personal writings?
Well, that's a great question. Yes, it takes a lot of time to assemble the books, figure out the covers. We've had a couple of different approaches on various issues with publishing. For a while, we were an imprint of a medium-sized house out of Boulder, and then that house, Big Earth Publishing, went bankrupt, and we had to move all the files around and get reorganized. But, you know, it's just such a labor of love. I have no problem working on Gary's stuff and trying to see what I can do to promote it and get the word out. All that good stuff. It's just such a joy based on the reaction. And for my own writing, I have always written early in the morning. It's just what I do. And I haven't changed that habit in, I don't know, 25 or 30 years. So that time is sacred. It's not that much of a challenge. It's just something I love to do. I love seeing these books reach readers.
And you kind of alluded to this already, the type of preparation that went into getting these books ready for publishing. Were they all completed or were they various stages of completion?
No, all these books are completed. You know, like any manuscript, they need work. You get fresh eyes on something and you're going to find things to clean up. So we do go through a solid editing process with all of them. But that being said, Gary left them in the shape where you can pick up the book and read it and get it. And he really went through these many, many times. Sometimes he'd go back a few years and pluck one off the shelf and work on it for a while and then show me the new version and then put it back. And so they were in really good shape. And I say 25, we have found some of his notes that at some point, we don't know exactly when, he took a bunch out and just dumped them. I really think, and I would bet that in his lifetime, he might have produced 40 or 50 books overall. I wouldn't be surprised at all.
Wow, that's prolific.
Yeah. One quick story I'd like to mention. That is that Gary was published once in his lifetime, and it was a short story. And think about this. In 1977, Gary submitted a short story, just send it into the Iowa Review, which is one of the premier short story fiction, you know, high echelon kind of journals. They probably get, I don't know, how many hundreds and hundreds of submissions. That story was published in the Iowa Review in 1977. In fact, it was the lead story in that journal, The Biography Man, it was called, by Gary Reilly. And it was later included the next year in the Pushcart Prize Anthology, which is the best of small publishers.
Oh, wow.
So Gary's one short story was in two short story collections, the Iowa Review and the Pushcart Prize. And after that, he was never published again until after he passed away. So this guy's quality was so up there. And we've put The Biography Man up on Amazon for 99 cents. If you want to read a remarkable bit of kind of odd sci-fi, kind of interesting commentary on modern day life, it's a classic story and it's just brilliantly written. And then compare the prose to something out of the Vietnam series or something out of his Asphalt Warrior series, and you'll see Gary had a real, real range.
You know, I feel that sometimes people are born to do certain things. And it seems like Gary was just a natural writer where it just kind of flowed with him. I mean, for one, to write one book is a challenge, let alone 25 plus, you know?
It's so true. And I think what you say is absolutely spot on. He was a born storyteller. He was a born writer. And he listened to that. And what I love so much about the story, the sad parts of the stories are just so obvious, but what I love about it is he did apply. He did try to get published. He did seek agents from time to time. He was easily discouraged about getting published, but he wasn't discouraged so much that he didn't continue to pursue his craft and pursue his art. And he had a lot to say. He had a very interesting point of view about the world, and he, I think, had some issues with bureaucracy and authority and power, and he really poured it into his characters and his books. And he was a totally natural storyteller, and he couldn't be stopped. He wrote right up to the end.
Yeah, yeah. And again, the story is just really touching because you also have to consider that this is his legacy. You know, this is what he left behind. This will live 100, 1,000 years from now, these words. And the fact that you're helping to bring life to them has to be pretty fulfilling even for yourself.
It's so fulfilling. I can tell you another quick story just to kind of share some of the quality I think is there. And that is that one day we got an email kind of out of the blue from a woman who said, just curious, when is the next Gary Reilly coming out? And as I always do when I don't know somebody, I say, I gave her some information. I said, by the way, you know, who are you and how did you find out about this? She turned out to be a woman who was buying books for a Ivy League university. She had spotted the Running Meter Press. That's the name of our company. She had spotted that name on the Library of Congress list of books that were going into the Library of Congress, because that's what you do when you're a publisher. You send your books to the Library of Congress for the record. And she started reading Gary Reilly. And she said not only had she started buying Gary's stuff and making sure they were in the Ivy League University's library, she said that Gary Reilly became one of her favorite writers of all time. This is somebody working for one of the top schools in the country who just simply discovered that, you know, here's this writer. And yes, it's not coming out of one of the big New York houses, but that doesn't mean the guy couldn't write.
Absolutely. And I mean, equality speaks for itself if it's reaching this many people. Were there any challenges you faced with publishing these books? I mean, I can imagine there were some emotional hurdles in addition to just the sheer volume of work.
Yeah, you know, the actual putting together of a book, actually, I'm one of those weird, strange people who love every bit of the process. I love the editing and the decision-making around some, you know, little lines here or there that might need tweaking. I love seeing a cover and the design come together. You know, I think the biggest challenge is the same challenge for any writer these days, and that's marketing. That's getting through the gigantic flood of books that comes out of not only the major publishing houses, but coming out of all the independents out there and self-publishing. And I think it's a beautiful, beautiful thing that the tools are out there now to publish so easily and that anybody's voice can be heard. But then the challenge for the publisher and the writer is to make sure you are getting through all that noise that's out there and finding those readers. So that's an ongoing, steady process. There's no end to it. There's no shortage of good you could do every day. I could get up tomorrow morning and spend the next 4 weeks doing nothing but marketing Gary Reilly's books. And that might be a very valuable, smart thing to do. It might pay off, but I can't afford that kind of time. And it might only find 10 more readers. You just don't know. It might find 1,000. I could put a box of books together and drive around to every bookstore in the Western United States and introduce bookstore owners to Gary and hopefully, you know, get the word spread that way. And I've done some of that. We've gone all over the place talking about Gary. We've gone to Nebraska and I've gone to, did an event up in Seattle, and I'm happy to talk to anybody anywhere about Gary, but you know, all we have is time and we have to balance. I think you used the word balance earlier and that is so apropos.
Okay, so let's talk about Discharge. This is the third book in a trilogy about Vietnam that followed the experiences of an enlisted man, Private Palmer. So for those unfamiliar with the previous books, can you tell us who Private Palmer is and some of his background?
I'd be glad to. The books are in three parts. The Enlisted Men's Club takes place before the war as Private Palmer is stationed at the Presidio in San Francisco. The second book, The Detachment, is the biggest of the three books. It's 154,000 words long, which is almost double the length of a normal book. And it is a thing of absolute beauty in my book. And that takes place all as Private Palmer is stationed at the Kenan Airfield, which is not surprisingly exactly where Gary Reilly was stationed. And the third book, The Discharge, takes place back in the United States, most of it in Denver, but the middle section takes place in both Los Angeles and San Francisco, and also follows Private Palmer at that point, or Palmer as he's known, not Private anymore, as he goes to California to chase a screenplay, potential writing gig, something that also happened to Gary. Well, Private Palmer is a terrific character. He is cynical. He skewers authority. He is always looking to stay out of the eye of his superior so he doesn't get any crap detail assigned to him. He has a harsher word for it. He's very interested in staying well buzzed by beer or whatever he can get a hold of. But in the Enlisted Men's Club, after all this setup and his jaded view, he is given a very special assignment and he is dispatched, I won't give it away, on an airplane. He has to go to Wichita. And it is just a transformational scene, and it changes his whole second half of the book. In The Detachment in Vietnam, it's something similar. He's back to drinking beer and back to still avoiding all the superiors and all their military ways. And he gets heavily involved in some heavy duty alternative substances. In my mind, he kind of steps up right to the edge of the abyss of hell and looks over the edge and almost jumps, but backs away. And again, the last third of that book is just a thing of beauty as, again, he has grown and learned. And then in the discharge, he's back home struggling with one of the great issues of modern and all, I believe probably all time, which is a returning soldier and how to reconnect with people and how to reconnect with society and find your feet after what you've seen and what you've gone through.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the discharge takes place several years after the war is over. It's in three parts. And in the third part, Palmer goes down and decides to become a taxi cab driver. And ironically, that is the exact same job which forms the basis for the Asphalt Warrior series, the eight books we've published so far based on Gary's adventures as a taxi cab driver. And those eight books are all played for humor. They're very, very funny books. The Vietnam series, of course, is quite sober and sobering. And to me, The Discharge is just one of those books that should have us all question, what do we really do? We ask these human beings to go off to other lands and kill and to fight and to see awful, brutal things. Anybody who's read some of the nonfiction accounts like Sebastian Younger's War, we've all read and consumed movies. We see war movies. We see lots of TV shows based on war. We've seen the documentaries. We've read the novels by Hemingway. And yet we don't really focus or even want to talk about or confront the issue of what's inside a soldier's head coming home. I mean, there is some talk about it, but to me, fiction is one way to try to grasp what that must really be like. And I think The Discharge does a great job.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, speaking of detachment, there's detachment on all fronts, you know, within the soldier that has to experience that and with the people who send that soldier into that situation. And for the folks that are detached from what war actually is, that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah, the three titles actually have a nice kind of double meaning to them all. And the Enlisted Men's Club is, once you start reading it, you know it's a kind of a wry use of that phrase. The Detachment, the second book, is a perfect use of a military phrase. And you know it's the state of mind of Palmer that's detached from the all that's going on around him. And then in The Discharge also, you know that there's just so many nice meanings to that. You might get an official discharge, but what does that really mean about life and who you are and your place in the world? And how are you going to find your way forward?
What other books are in the pipelines or in the works for Gary?
Well, Mike and I are every time at about this point, when we're about a week or so away from the launch of one book, we are always looking down the road at the next. So we haven't settled on the next title. It obviously won't be the Vietnam series because that's done. Gary has given us many, many choices at this point. We could do what we believe is the last book in the cab driving series, but I'm going to push for one of the non-series books. He wrote some straight up crime fiction. He wrote some fantasy. He actually wrote a couple books that are just straight up literary fiction, multi-generational, all-American literary fiction. So I don't know for sure what the choice is going to be. Well, we're probably looking at about another 9 or 10 month process till we publish the next one, but we're still only coming up on about the halfway point of going through the books. And we're sort of at an interesting point, having finished the Vietnam stuff and getting close to finishing the cab driving series. We are going to start sorting through the others, and he's got some gems in there, some real, real gems.
Do you and Mike personally have any book projects that you're working on right now?
I just turned in a standalone to my agent. It's not connected to my series. And I also have last fall finished the fifth in my series. So I have actually in a weird position where I have two completed books, and we're probably spend the summer working on the standalone and then maybe head to market, try to look for a publisher this fall for that. So I'm very excited about that project. And Mike, he's working on some short stories. We met a couple weeks ago and he's got a great idea for a series of short stories, but I think that's going to take him a little bit of time to put together, but it sounds absolutely terrific.
Well, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for all your fantastic questions and your interest. I really appreciate it.
Where can readers find your work and more of Gary's books online?
My website is writermarkstevens.com. I'm on Twitter at writerstevens. Also Facebook, there's an Allison Coyle Facebook page. My main character is a female hunting guide in the Flat Tops Wilderness of Colorado. And Gary Reilly is all the Asphalt Warrior. So it's theasphaltwarrior.com. On Facebook, look up the Asphalt Warrior. On Twitter, it's asphalt_warrior on Twitter. And the Asphalt Warrior actually tweets every day, and there's fresh posts on Facebook every day. And it's a great place to connect with the world of Gary Reilly.
And with that, we'll wrap up another episode. You know, I said it several times during the interview, but that is just such a compelling story, what Mark and Mike are doing for Gary. And we would all be so lucky to have friends like that. So definitely be sure to check out The Discharge, part of the Vietnam series, and also Gary's Asphalt Warrior series. And as always, if you have a question or comment about this episode or any, or you know an author who you think would be a good fit for the show, let me know. Connect with me on social media. I'm on Facebook, the Twitter, Instagram, and I have a personal page on YouTube that I really need to do something with. Or you can send an email to me at info@ch1podcast.com. That's it for me. Till next time.